I love solar power, and the world is loving it too. Because at this point, the globally installed solar power increases almost exponentially. And it is no wonder, because you can get solar panels for dirt cheap nowadays. And if you combine them with a PV inverter, you can, for example, charge up your electric car, or even power your entire house for free. It is crazy how the prices for PV stuff are constantly dropping, but that really got me wondering how good they actually are. For example, I found this 5kW PV inverter online for 350 euro, which in comparison to the 5kW inverter I use right here, is half its price. So what can I say? I got myself such an inverter out of curiosity. And in this video, we will not only find out how well it performs, but also try some adventurous hardware hacking, using the newest technology of MOSFET semiconductors on the market. Let's get started! This video is sponsored by Infineon, who not only produce all kinds of awesome semiconductors, but also the newest MOSFET technology based on silicon carbide, or SiC, which will be featured in this video. Now to get started, I firstly unpacked my super cheap inverter, and I gotta admit that it looked pretty promising from the outside. By the way, this thing can be used with or without a grid connection, which is important for testing, because I'm not allowed to simply hook up a random inverter to the power grid. So I will be using it in off-grid mode to power some example loads, which I got right here in the form of a 2kW heating rod and 3kW heating rod, that obviously combined equals a 5kW load. But before getting to those, I firstly opened up the connection panel of the inverter, and it seems like we can hook up solar panels and or a battery as a power source. Now since nice weather is not always guaranteed, I wanted to be on the safe side for testing and supply a constant energy source, which is why I went with this 15kWh 48V battery monster. So after utilizing its given wires to connect it to the inverter, as well as hooking up the given Wi-Fi module, I turned it all on and was super happy that nothing exploded. At this point, I had a look at the main display and all the data it is providing. And oh boy, that was a lot, which luckily gets all explained in the manual. I of course also tried setting up the Wi-Fi connection, but that was basically a nightmare, and thus I gave up after around 20 minutes of pure frustration. But that doesn't matter that much, because we are mostly after the AC output voltage, and according to my multimeter, we are dealing with close to 230 volts AC here, which is of course the grid voltage here in Germany. And when having a look at it with the oscilloscope, then the sinusoidal shape looks pretty good, except near the zero crossing points. But let's find out how it holds up while powering some beefy loads. And for that, I simply filled up a bucket of water, placed the heating rod in there, and connected it all to the inverter. And no matter whether I hooked up 2, 3 or 5 kilowatts, the sine voltage always looked pretty good, and all loads got powered properly without any problems. Lovely! But as you can hear, this thing got louder and louder with its fans while outputting more power. Because, of course, the more power we want, the more current has to flow. And that means more power losses and thus heat that we need to get rid of. To put numbers behind this claim, I monitored what power the battery outputs and what the load on the inverter was drawing. By doing some math, we end up with these power losses and efficiencies. And truth be told, I was surprised that such a cheap Chinese inverter would reach efficiencies above 90%. But maybe we can improve those even more. I mean, my modern Fronius inverter here for reference reaches around 98%. So let's have a closer look inside my cheapy and find out where most of the heat gets produced. Which was easier said than done, because to properly see everything, I wanted to get it all out of the housing. This definitely took some time, and it felt like I was breaking some things. But eventually I got it all out, and after once again hooking up the battery, it still all turned on perfectly fine and was outputting our 230 volt AC voltage. Now at this point, you probably already guessed that the components that produce the most heat are tied to these big heat sinks. In our case though, we are not interested in the right heat sink, because these MOSFETs are apparently used to interact with solar panels that I didn't hook up. Instead, we need to focus on the left heat sink, where we got some bigger components, which according to their part number are IGBTs. Now IGBTs, just like MOSFETs, are more or less electrically controlled switches. In such an inverter, you control these switches with an SPWM signal, which is basically a PWM signal whose duty cycle alters according to the voltage value of a sine voltage. And thus, after some filtering, we got an AC sine voltage on the output. So they are the heart and soul of this inverter. And while doing a 10-minute 2kW load test, we can see through the thermal camera how some eat up to above 40°C. And the one I observed specifically at the start got up to 39°C. So needless to say, these apparently produce the most heat, meaning by replacing them with better semiconductor switches, we could improve efficiency. Which is why I first removed all of the IGBTs, and that definitely took some patience. But eventually I got them all out, and at this point we need to understand how most power losses get created through such switches. And the main two losses are conduction losses and switching losses. Now the first one is super simple to understand, since this specific IGBT comes with a typical collector emitter saturation voltage, which is there when the IGBT is fully turned on. Multiply this with the flowing current, which for my example here is 50 amps, and you got conduction losses of 88.5 watt. As a comparison, this SiC MOSFET from Infineon comes with a drain source resistance of 19 milliohm, which is also there when fully turned on. So by doing the math again, we get a loss of only 47.5 watt here, which is a nice difference. And in case you're wondering, this SiC MOSFET is something relatively new. So far, we mostly used classical Si MOSFETs made of silicon, but now we got the new SiC kind, made up of silicon carbide. This material change basically improves all MOSFET properties when being used with a high voltage. And as you guessed it, PV inverters use rather high voltages. But getting back to topic and the remaining switching losses. To showcase those a bit more spectacular though, I first had to populate this rather interesting PCB, created by Martin from Infineon. Now this board will be part of a double pulse test, which sounds simple, but was quite complicated at the end. The main idea is that you basically turn on the MOSFET or IGBT two times in a row using two pulses. For the load, we will be using a hand-wound air coil that comes with an inductance of around 56 microhenry. That means that as soon as the switch is turned on, current starts rising almost linear through the switch. And at a point of around 50 amps, we turn the switch off, let the current freewheel a bit through the diode of a second semiconductor, and then turn it on again, so that we got some hot switching here, and lots of current flowing again. Now what we want to observe is this switch off and this switch on behavior, which, yes, reveals the switching losses. And this intriguing looking PCB basically houses all necessary components, along with a current shunt to monitor the current. And the layout of the components is arranged in such a way to minimize parasitic inductances. And with the theory out of the way, I prepared my final test setup and did the double pulse test firstly with the IGBTs and then with the SiC MOSFETs. the results looked very lovely. And here we can see the switching losses, which are basically the time periods in which current flows, but the IGBT or MOSFET has not fully opened or closed its conduction path yet. So by multiplying the area below the current and drain source voltage or collector emitter voltage line, we would end up with the switching losses. Needless to say, the SiC MOSFET is quite a bit faster, and thus the power loss area is less, meaning once again, it beats the IGBT. But to really prove that, we should use the SiC MOSFETs in our cheapy inverter, which I did next. Now at this point, I actually expected some explosions or similar, but everything powered up nicely, and we still got 230 volts AC on the outputs. Awesome! That means it was time to do my power tests once again. And it seems like the SiC MOSFETs really lowered power losses, and thus increased the overall efficiency, which was definitely noticeable, because the semiconductors no longer got that hot. Now of course, we're not at 98% yet, but we have to keep in mind that the driver stage here is optimized for IGBTs, meaning there might be room for even more improvement in the future. But so far we can conclude that cheap Chinese inverters are pretty decent actually, and I hope you got to know and learn something about SiC MOSFETs. If so, don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. Stay creative, and I will see you next time!